It's a pleasure to see so many of you here today. As those of you who have organized and facilitated programs in parishes, diocesan level, you know the feeling that Melinda and I shared yesterday in anticipation of whether this was actually going to happen or not. So we're thrilled to be here and thrilled to be sharing sharing this day with you. Just so you know, for the speaker for this morning, the yellow sheet in your packet is going to be the handout that we use. And with that in mind, it's my pleasure to introduce to you Father Anthony Gittins, a member of the Congregation of the Holy Ghost, who was born in Manchester, England, and was ordained in 1967. He holds a PhD in social anthropology from the University of Edinburgh, Scotland, and pursued postdoctoral research at the universities of Oxford and Cambridge. From 1984 until 2011, Professor Gittins taught theology and anthropology at the Catholic Theological Union in Chicago. He held the Bishop Ford Chair of Mission Theology for 9 years and is now Professor Emeritus of Theology and Culture there. Professor Gittins co-taught courses with professors of Bible, liturgy, and pastoral care, focusing on the interfaith between the social sciences and the theological disciplines. He continues to do consulting work and offers workshops, seminars, and retreats in more than 35 countries from Africa to the Pacific. Along with his distinguished academic work, Father Gittins has also maintained a generous pastoral ministry. For almost 30 years, he worked with and among homeless women on the streets of Chicago and now serves in a soup kitchen. For 7 of those years, he was a part of Genesis House, a community where women struggle to escape from prostitution. Prior to coming to Chicago in 1984, for almost a decade, Father Gittins worked among the Mende people of Sierra Leone, West Africa, as a missionary, pastor, linguist, and ethnographer. Since then, he's done missionary anthropological work in a number of countries beyond Africa, including Pakistan, Kiribati, and Tribriyan Islands. Father Gittins is the author of 15 books on theological and anthropological topics and on mission and spirituality. Most recently, Where There's Hope, There's Life, Women's Stories and Pastoral Practical Theology from Legora Press in 2006, and Called to be Sent, Co-missioned as Disciples Today from Legora Press in 2008. Now, the fact is we don't often speak of priests as grandparents, but Father Gittins is the exception. He has an adopted multi-ethnic family, a daughter and her husband, 4 grandchildren, and 3 great-grandchildren. Please welcome Father Anthony Gittins, scholar, pastor, missionary, author, and grandfather.
Much. That's more than I deserve. Am I switched on? Does it sound okay? All right. Thank you so much. That was very sweet, very nice. I'm honored and I'm delighted to be here. I want to start with a little reflection. It's a like a prayer, but it's not entirely a prayer. Jesus says that in his society there's a new way for people to live. You show wisdom by trusting people. You handle leadership by serving. You handle offenders by forgiving. You handle money by sharing. You handle enemies by loving. And you handle violence by suffering. In fact, you have a new attitude toward everything and toward everybody, because this is a Jesus society, and you repent not by feeling bad, but by thinking differently. So this morning I want to see if we can think differently about mission and evangelization. It's a whole lot easier to feel bad than it is to think differently. We Catholics are quite good at feeling bad. Sometimes the badder we feel, the better it makes us feel. But I sometimes talk to people of different Christian denominations and beyond, and I've come to the steadfast conclusion these days that Catholics actually are only about third best at feeling bad. Lutherans, by their own self-proclamation, are by far the best at feeling bad, and Presbyterians want to get in on it too. So they look at us and they say, you think you feel bad? Well, you should see the way we could do this. The problem, of course, is that the badder you feel, less is done to change the world. You use all your energy feeling bad instead of using your energy to think differently. And the difficulty, of course, is that our culture, almost by definition, teaches us how to think. And once we've grown to a certain degree, we think in a certain kind of way. And we obviously think that the way we think is the right way to think. It gets very dangerous sometimes when we think that the way we think is the way everybody else should think. And it gets particularly toxic when we think that the way we think is the way God thinks. So if we're going to repent, we have to rethink, think differently about a variety of different things. And I want to start off with thinking about mission. And it's curious and sad and interesting and all kinds of paradoxical things that last night, as I was watching the television, and I'm sure most of you were, I heard the announcer say that the police had successfully completed their mission. We live in a world where McDonald's has a mission statement. Mary Knoll has a mission statement. And the church has a mission statement. And it makes you kind of ask yourself, what, in fact, are we talking about when we're talking about mission statements and we're talking about mission? Many religious communities, many hospitals have mission statements. And many of those mission statements tend to start off explicitly or implicitly with the word I or we. And many mission statements are about what we intend to do for the rest of the world. That's fine, but it's not fine enough. So I'm going to put, at the end, I'm going to put three words on the board, but the first one is just going to be mission. I realize that you people over there can't see me now, therefore you can't see the board, but I'm just going to put the word mission. If I can, oh, how nice. How nice, it comes down to my level, that's great. And I'm going to start off by saying that the subject of mission is God. The subject of mission is God. And that leaves us with an enormous dilemma, because God is mystery. And there is nothing coherent that we can say about God that does justice to God in any way at all. So to say that God is mission is not to say very much. But to try to talk about God is to acknowledge that we can't say very much. All theological language is the language of analogy, because that's the best thing we can do. We can say God is like, because we can't say God is, because we don't know who or what God is. And even in the ordinary course of language, we say God is in a variety of ways, but what we really mean is something beyond that. If I say God is love, what I really mean is God is what I think love is, except so much bigger and so different as to be completely other than what I think. Okay. If I say God is beauty or God is truth, it's the same thing. I'm saying something like, God is what I think these things are, except qualitatively and quantitatively different. So what can I say about God? Very little. So over 2,000 years of Christian history, people have tried very hard to speak about God, and typically when you try to approach the mystery and you realize that it's not possible to embrace the mystery, you come up with a nice fancy little phrase, preferably in a foreign language, that few people can understand. Missio Dei, I put there on that page, is simply to remind us that the mission is the mission of God. Dei is of God. Missio is mission. We still don't know what mission is, but it's of God. Okay? So God is the subject. The other one I put down there was Bonaventure, who uses this hundreds of times. Bonum diffusivum sui. Bonum, good, goodness. Sui, self, of self, and diffusivum, spread. So Bonaventure is trying to talk about God as self-diffusive goodness, right? When I first came to Chicago in 84, everybody was talking about you-know-what hitting the fan. And I think almost of God's mission as God's goodness hitting the cosmic fan. So that wherever there is goodness, there is God. And it's driven by God. It's dynamic. So Bonaventure wants to talk about God's self-diffusive goodness. But in more recent years, we've tried to find an English analogy or an analogy in the English language that people can understand a bit more readily than bonum diffusivum sui. And the analogy that has got some widespread currency is what's referred to as the organic analogy. And the organic analogy is simply breathing. So we're now going to talk about God's mission as God's breathing. And we start off by saying that in breathing, we've got to distinguish, or we've got to separate, at least analytically, breathing out and breathing in. It would do very, very little good if I told you all to breathe out for the next 10 minutes, and this group would be breathing in. We've got to do it together. We've got to do it together. So breathing out and breathing in is an attempt to describe something of God's mission. And the breathing out is very simple. It's expressed beautifully in the prayer, "Send forth your spirit, and they shall be created, and you will renew the face of the earth." So there you've got a sense of God's mission, coming from the center and going out. Centrifugal movement, going to the ends of the earth and existing before time began. The mission of God is the mission of God's Trinity, not just the mission of Jesus. It's the mission of the Trinity. And this "send forth your spirit" goes back to the first verse of Genesis, the spirit brooding over the waters. So that the Spirit of God is the creative breath of God, the breathing creation. And therefore, anything and everything that exists exists by virtue of God's creative breath. Nothing exists without it. But since God's creative breath goes back into the midst of time, before time began, then God's mission goes back as far as that too. God's mission doesn't have to wait for Jesus. And God's mission certainly doesn't have to wait for the church. God's mission is primeval. Okay? But that's the breathing out. Now we've got to get the breathing in. And the breathing in is very well kind of captured, in a sense, by the Hebrew Bible. The whole of the story of the Hebrew Bible is the story of the people who have somehow gone away and gone astray and lost it. And God is saying, "Come back to me, my people. Come back to me, my people." So the breathing in of God is the gathering, the unification, the reconciliation, the healing, the calling. Because God created us, and God called us to be sent to the ends of the earth, and the danger is that as we moved across the face of the earth, we lost our sense of God, and we became separated from God, and we thought we could do it on our own. And so God is constantly saying, "Come back to me, my people." And then if we can come back to God, which is part of God's mission, drawing us in, then God can then again breathe us out and send us in some way to be involved and invested in this eternal mission of God. So we've got that analogy about God's breathing in and breathing out. And it is about as far as we can go with God, because we then have to say, no, we can't add very much to this. We're talking about mystery, and words fail. It's more or less at this point, then, that we get the second phase, if you like, of God's mission. Because in the fullness of time, God's mission is going to come down on earth, or down to earth. And when Jesus teaches his disciples to pray, he will tell them to pray that God's will should continue to be done on earth as it is in heaven. And the "as it is in heaven," if you like, is the eternal mission of God. And the "as it is on earth" is the earthly mission of God. And the earthly mission of God comes to us, into our history. It's the historicization of mission, okay? The mission of God is before history and outside history, beyond history. the mission of God is going to come down into our history and impinge upon our consciousness in a way that now we can grasp it more readily. We can't grasp the enormity of God, but we can grasp it more readily because it's going to come down in a human being like us, born 2,000 years ago, speaking a particular language, living in a particular culture, in a particular social locality. And what is going to happen then is that the mission is going to come down to earth among us, and it's going to continue. And we've got a one-word job description for God, if you like, by calling God the mission. The mission is describing what God does for a living. Now we need a one-word job description for Jesus, who brings this mission down to earth. And this one-word job description now can be evangelization. And evangelization effectively is nothing other than the mission of God brought down to earth, brought down to my level, to a level that I can comprehend, brought down to eye level, because Jesus sits at table, and if you sit at table with people, you are at eye level. So this is eye level mission, eye level ministry. But to understand how this is the eternal mystery now brought into history, we have to try and figure it out and ask a number of questions. Unfortunately, people have asked these questions before us. And the first one to kind of ask the question about the connection between Jesus and evangelization and the Trinity and mission is very close to the very end of Jesus' life, where Philip is the one. He's the kind of the fall guy, really. And he says, just show us the Father and then we'll understand. Or just show us the Father, then we'll believe. So Philip is asking for a revelation about this universal mission. And I'm sure Jesus claps himself on the head and says, Philip, have I been with you so long? And still you don't understand. And then Jesus begins to explain and give the answer to how he and the eternal mission of the Father are related. The Father and I are one, he says. I did not come to do my own will. I came to do the will of the one who missioed me, the one who sent me, okay? And he will constantly tie what he is doing to what his Abba has sent him to do, or what his Abba has always been doing. And when he actually proclaims his own mission statement that we have in a rudimentary form in Luke chapter 4, he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me and has sent me. And there you've got this eternal mission coming to Jesus and through Jesus to the rest of the community, the rest of the world. So as you reflect on the way Jesus answers Philip's question, you get the connection then between the eternal mission of God and the historic mission of Jesus. And if we can use evangelization in a very specific sense as a job description for Jesus and a job description for the way Jesus does mission, then really all we have to do is to expand it a little bit more and says, ask the question, well, okay, what exactly does Jesus do? And if you ask that question, first of all, you can answer it by saying, whatever it is, it's mission. Because Jesus is absolutely committed to his Abba. Everything that Jesus does is done in obedience to the mission and in obedience to his Abba. So if you try very hard and you comb through the New Testament, you can easily come up with about 20 different aspects of evangelization, okay? 20 different aspects of the way in which Jesus is doing the mission. And all of those indicate the dynamic nature of his mission. Evangelization is sometimes reduced to the word proclamation, and it's sometimes reduced to the translation, the good news. Evangelization is not the good news. Evangelization is far more dynamic than that. If I was to bring in a newspaper, whether it was today's or yesterday's, and leave it on the table and say, there's the news, that's no place for the news. The news should be around. It should be alive. It should be about. Jesus is the good news. Jesus doesn't just talk about it. Jesus doesn't just refer people to it. Jesus is it. Jesus is healing. Not just talking about healing. Jesus is reconciliation. Not just talking about it. Not just promising it, but being it. So the word evangelization itself needs to be shifted so that it's not just a noun, but it's a verb. Mission needs to be shifted, so it's not just a noun, it's a verb, it's a dynamic activity. So what we can do with evangelization, at the very least, is to turn it into a participle, and we can speak about evangelizing, and we can say that Jesus came to evangelize, and his entire life is evangelizing. He is being the good news. And it's a very immediate good news. Now, you may notice that I speak in a funny kind of way, relatively speaking. And we in England use relatively strange spelling. So evangelizing in my form of English is evangelizing. But the last four letters then would be S-I-N-G, whereas in American English, the last four letters would be Z-I-N-G. So the issue is that Jesus is the one who puts the zing in evangelizing. And it sounds stronger than Jesus is the sing or the song or the singer. But it amounts to the same thing even in English, that Jesus is the one who is singing the good news, the one who is bringing the good news, not just the one who's talking about it. And a lot of evangelization today in our time is talking about it or telling other people about it or reducing it to a program or stuffing it into questions and answers. Many, many of the answers being answers to questions that people don't ask anymore. And evangelization can become so reduced. But Jesus is the evangelizing of God. And if we don't put the zing into evangelizing, there's no zing. There's no evangelizing. There's no reality. There's no truth. There's no authenticity. So if we look at evangelization or evangelizing, and we identify anything around 20 ways in which Jesus does this, from walking around to being tired to sitting down to receiving a drink from the woman at the well, you can kind of see how many facets there are of evangelizing. It encapsulates the entirety of Jesus' life, the whole of his life. He's totally, totally dedicated to the mission. But psychologists tell us we can't carry around 20 things in our head all the time. But most of us can carry four or three. And it's very useful that we've got a wide consensus in the theological fields these days that if you want to reduce evangelization, in other words, the way Jesus does mission, Jesus being the subject, to four cardinal headings, like north, south, east, and west, you can reduce them quite nicely to proclamation, witness, dialogue, and liberation. But what you're doing when you're doing that is just taking out of the total 20 or more and bringing it down to four that you can kind of think about and you can hold on to. But these four together would be integral evangelization, which is to say that if we break them up, we are not doing justice to Jesus, because Jesus does not break them up. Jesus integrates them. And if we break them up, we are disintegrating them. Proclamation, witness, dialogue, and liberation. Jesus does all of the above. And if we come along later and we presume to do some evangelizing, then we'd better be sure, A, that we do all four, or we attend equally to all four, and B, that we realize that this is not multiple choice. Okay. It is not only not multiple choice, but it's not a hierarchy either. It represents four components of the way Jesus brings the good news and continues the eternal mission of God, all of which are necessary. But in recent years, in an attempt to kind of dumb down a little bit or make ourselves more comprehensible to people, we have very often taken the word evangelization and presumed to retranslate it as proclamation or something to that effect. And that, of course, is not to do justice to Jesus. It's to disintegrate what should be part of an integrated package. Certainly, unquestionably, Jesus proclaimed. But equally certainly, Jesus did more than proclamation. Therefore, evangelization is more than proclamation, because Jesus is the model. Jesus is the subject. Okay. So we've got to understand that they are integrated. They're not a hierarchy. Proclamation is no more important, nor is it less important than liberation, because for Jesus it wasn't. It was part and parcel of what he did day after day after day. I'll come back to this in a minute. But the question then arises, given the eternal mission of God, given the fact that it has come down to earth 2,000 years ago in Jesus in the Galilee, and given that Jesus only has 2 or 3 years of public life, what's going to happen to the mission after Jesus ascends? Okay. What is going to happen to this mission? Is it going to continue on earth as it is in heaven? And the answer, of course, is yes. And the way it continues is precisely Jesus' way. And the way of Jesus is to spend his waking hours and sometimes his sleeping hours ensuring that there are witnesses who will continue the mission. And those witnesses are disciples. And the one word job description for disciples is discipleship. So now we've got three words on the board. And what it does for us then is it helps us to identify the relationship between discipleship and evangelization. Just as it helps us to determine the relationship between evangelization and mission. Discipleship has a job description, but it is not a job description that is determined by the disciples. Is it a job description that is given to them by a teacher, Jesus? So the disciples' job is to do what they have learned from Jesus, which is evangelization. To be faithful to Jesus. To carry out what Jesus has done and what Jesus has taught them to do in his name. So that the mission is continued in a whole cloth way, not just partly. But given that evangelization itself describes the way in which Jesus does mission and continues the eternal mission, then it follows that if disciples are doing what they should be doing, they are in fact directly involved in the eternal mission of God, given that they are not eternal and they are on earth. But it is the same mission, continued through time, and through the example of Jesus, who has disclosed to us what it consists of. So that therefore now disciples, in order to really reflect upon their own job description, have got to go back to Jesus and have got to go back to these four components. Again, remember that beyond the four components are up to 20 that you might think about. And there's one critical one that I haven't put on the board, because I used to think that it was self-evident, but people ask sometimes about it and where it should be. And of course, it's prayer and contemplation. And it is the dynamo. It's the whole, you know, without prayer and contemplation, there is no effective proclamation, witness, dialogue, and liberation. It's the fuel that gets the rocket to take off. It's the gas in your Rolls Royce. You can have a beautiful Rolls Royce, but if there's no gas, there's no movement. Prayer is what gets the whole thing moving and keeps it all moving. And it's palpable that this is what Jesus sees as what drives the mission. His ongoing developing relationship, his continuous relationship with his Abba. He's consistently depleted, and then he goes away and prays and spends nights and time, hours in prayer in order to come down and, having been filled up, to be depleted again. Okay, so prayer is the foundation, if you like, of evangelization. Then we can start off with proclamation and witness as two sides of the same coin. The best way to identify a witness would be proclamation with your mouth shut. It has been spoken of quite lyrically and beautifully by Paul VI and John Paul II, when they've talked about, you know, the witness of life is more effective than people talking about God. So proclamation is verbal, it's formal, it's systematic. It's important because it's important for Jesus. Everything goes back to Jesus. Jesus proclaims the good news of the kingdom, the good news of salvation, the good news of the Basileia. So proclamation is formal, organized, systematic. And witness is less so, less formal, less organized, less systematic. You remember the prayer of Francis of Assisi. Proclaim the good news always, and if necessary, use words. Meaning that words are not necessarily necessary, but proclamation is. And proclamation with your mouth shut is effective. Witness, of course, in English derives from the Greek word martyr, which gives us the other English word martyr. So witness is both witness and martyr. The only difference being the way you die. Essentially, they're the same thing. You witness with your life until you die by natural causes. And if you're a martyr, you witness with your life until you die by unnatural causes. But you witness with your life, and your life is your witness. And the example is Jesus, who gave his life. So witness and proclamation are two sides of a coin. Dialogue, and again, all of these four are derivative of the way Jesus does mission, the way he evangelizes. This third one was not terribly well developed until relatively recently because of the fact that many Christians, many Catholics particularly perhaps, had a very, very high Christology from John's Gospel, where you get John saying things like, and Jesus knew what was going to happen, and he knew what was in their hearts. It must have been a fairly tedious life for Jesus if he knew what if he knew what his mother was going to have for dinner the following week. What's there to look forward to? So we didn't think that Jesus needed to dialogue very much because he knew everything. Okay. But in more recent years, we've become much more conscious of the fact that the New Testament is riddled with examples of Jesus in dialogue, and particularly with the relationship that Jesus has with women. The dialogue brings him to a different place. Okay. But there are three components of dialogue. First of all, dialogue changes both parties, which is, again, one of the reasons why people were a bit skittish about talking about Jesus in dialogue, because Jesus doesn't change. Well, he's a human being. Of course he does. He grows. To live is to change. So dialogue changes both parties, and anything that is dressed up as dialogue but does not undertake to allow oneself to be changed, but only wants to change the other party, it's hypocrisy. It's mock dialogue. The second point about dialogue is that the outcome of dialogue cannot be known in advance. And again, this exposes some things that are sometimes called dialogue. Because sometimes some people go into dialogue with a very, very clear agenda. Okay? The outcome of dialogue cannot be known in advance because dialogue is placing oneself under the Holy Spirit. This is what Jesus is doing. The Syrophoenician woman says to Jesus, I need some help. And Jesus says, I only came to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And she says, wait a minute, young man. Wait a minute. Slow down. And at the end of this story, Jesus says, oh, woman, great is your faith. I have not found faith like this in Israel. This is an astonishing move, okay? And this woman has brought Jesus to a new understanding of his own mission, okay? So dialogue changes both parties. And we again, you know, to get back to the fancy footwork that I've tried to avoid for the last 20 minutes, the tertium quid is involved here. If you want to know what the tertium quid is, then you need to know some Latin. Tertium would be the third, and the quid would be what? So the tertium quid would be the third what? Now it's all clear, right? So if you start off with two people, Mr. or Mrs. A and Mr. or Mrs. B, that's the first what? A. B is the second what. Now the third what is anywhere except A and B. So the outcome of dialogue cannot be known in advance. The third what could be over here or down here, because these both parties could be brought to this point, or both parties could be brought to this point. Okay? They are brought to a new point. They don't abandon their integrity. They don't compromise their integrity, but they come to new insights, and both of them do. So if you have a Christian and a Muslim in authentic dialogue, they will both come to another place. The Christian and the Muslim may still be Christian and Muslim, but they should be better Christians and better Muslims because they've got some new insight. So the third what is a willingness to go to a place that we can't control and we can't foresee. So that's the second component, or the second characteristic, if you like, of evangelization, that the outcome cannot be known in advance. And the third characteristic of dialogue is that from a structural point of view, dialogue and hierarchy are incompatible. Very simply, structurally, hierarchy is a vertical arrangement. Dialogue is a horizontal arrangement. So you can't have them occupying both planes at the same time. There's nothing wrong with hierarchy. Jesus expresses hierarchy. Jesus has authority. Right now, I'm the only one in this room standing up. That's a vertical arrangement. That's a hierarchical arrangement. Therefore, by definition, it's not a dialogue we're having. If I get to the end of this talk and we have some question and answer, I may still be standing up, but metaphorically, I should be sitting down. Because then we can talk to each other. So there's nothing wrong with hierarchy, but it cannot occupy the same plane as dialogue. It has to yield. And again, some of the things that we refer to, or some people refer to as dialogue, are not dialogical if one party insists on the hierarchical position. So there's three elements of dialogue, and you can see them in Jesus. The last one is liberation. And liberation, of course, has become a neuralgic word in theological circles, to my mind, largely because it has not been identified primarily with Jesus. If it were primarily identified with Jesus, there could be absolutely no problem with liberation. And I'm primarily identifying it with Jesus as one of the major components of evangelization. And he says it himself. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me and has sent me to do what? Liberate. Liberate. All right? Sent me to. In fact, what Jesus is saying is not sent me to ensure that the program is well articulated and maintained. Jesus doesn't have a program. Jesus has much more what I would like to call a discovery process. And a discovery process means you go looking for trouble. Trouble is people. Trouble is people in trouble. And that's exactly what Jesus does. He spends his life looking for trouble. Looking for troubled people. And then doing something about it. And when he articulates his own mission statement, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me and has sent me, the rest of what he actually says, and you remember, is effectively, sent me to look for whatever needs to be done, wherever it needs to be done, by whoever needs it. That's what he's saying. That's not a program. If Jesus had a program, first of all, he would have had a secretary. And then he would have had an office. And then he would have had notices. And the notices might have said, Monday, tax collectors. Tuesday, Pharisees. Wednesday, women of ill repute. And so on and so forth. There's a program. And you find the programmatic element very, very well articulated when Jesus goes into the synagogue and he sees the woman who's been bent over for 18 years. And Jesus calls her out and says, you are healed, which is a divine passive. It's a way of saying God has healed you. It's also in the past tense. It has already happened. You are healed of your infirmity. Whereupon, of course, the officials of the synagogue get very, very upset. And they said, we have a program. You should have come on one of the days when da 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 da. And you remember what Jesus says? You hypocrites. You two-faced people. You are making your program more important than this woman. And I'm going to set this woman, in fact, she's already free now. She's already liberated on the Sabbath day. Because to prefer a program to people, even to prefer the law to people, is hypocritical. So Jesus has a discovery procedure. And his discovery procedure is looking for people who need to be liberated. And the word that crops up probably most often in the Hebrew Bible, if not liberation, is restoration. And you actually get it in Isaiah 61, which is the passage that Jesus is quoting from, that we have in Luke 4, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me and sent me. And when you get to verses 3 and 4, which Luke doesn't quote, it's talking about the restoration. You know, you are to be made restored in many ways. You are ruined cities. You are to be restored. You are broken down. You are to be oak trees of integrity. It's an astonishing image that Jesus gives of restoration. And when he says to Bartimaeus, what do you want me to do for you? Bartimaeus is absolutely sure and certain when he says, I just want to see again. That's restoration. He doesn't want a house in the country. He doesn't want a pension. He doesn't even want health insurance. He just wants to see again. In other words, to be restored to the normal circumstances of a human being. And when Jesus meets this woman who's been bent over for 18 years, he restores her. And it says, the gospel tells us, and she stood up straight, which is restoration, humanity, and began praising God. Interestingly enough, it doesn't tell us anything about what she said or whether, in fact, she said anything. It just says she stood up straight and began praising God. I believe personally that if this is not the first example on record of the hokey cokey, then it's the first example of liturgical dance. Because she's suddenly got use of the limbs that she had no use before. And I have a feeling that she's doing it deliberately, and Jesus is encouraging her to deliberately dance in the synagogue on the Sabbath day in front of the officials who are apoplectic by this time. She puts her left leg in and she shakes it all over. And there's your liberation. So Jesus is a liberator, you know, in a modest enough way, you know. But the problem, of course, in recent years with liberation theology is that it became so attached in certain people's minds to a Marxist ideology. And if it is attached to a Marxist ideology, then it's reprehensible. But I'm not talking Marxist ideology, I'm talking Jesus. I'm talking evangelization. And there absolutely can be no way in which that is reprehensible. So of course what we have to do is to rethink. What do we mean by liberation and how are we involved and invested in liberation? So baptism is what allows us to participate in evangelization as disciples. Why is that? Well, the answer is very simple. Because when Jesus gives his own job description, his own description of the mission, the evangelization that is his entire life, he links it to the eternal Trinity. The Spirit of the Lord has been given to me and sent me. And every single person who is baptized into the same Spirit. So every adult who really wants to be confirmed in their baptism should be able to say, as Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me and has sent me. The only question then is, sent me to do what? And if I'm not very careful, I can go off at a tangent. There's a lot of us who want to do good things. There's a lot of us who want to do good things for God. And there may be quite a lot of us who expect God to be thoroughly grateful. But there's something wrong there. There's something slightly whiffy about that. You know, I've got to be a little sure that what I want to do for God is something like what God wants me to do, and not just my own thing. Because if it's my own thing, it's not discipleship. Discipleship is following what I've learned from the one who teaches, the teacher. So if you want to think about discipleship and evangelization, you can go back to these four components of Jesus' life. But the interesting thing to me about discipleship is that it is both personal and communal. We are called Not me. We are called personally, called by name, called as individuals, but not called to be individualists. Discipleship is for individuals in community, in relation to others. Which means to say that I can ask myself a question at an individual level about my conformity with Jesus' expectations. How am I proclaiming and witnessing and dialoguing and liberating? And I can probably score myself high on one of the four, but if I'm honest, I will probably have to score myself very low on at least one of the other ones of the four. So for me, as a personal individual, discernment, I've got to find out how I'm integrating those four, because they need to be integrated. But then the second question I can ask myself is, okay, how am I relating what I am doing to my community? My community can be a nuclear family. It can be an extended family. It can be a parish. It could be a religious community. It could be all kinds of things. And it could be several. It could be overlapping communities. But all of us live in relation to a community. And therefore, we can ask ourselves, in relation to the community, how am I proclaiming, witnessing, dialoguing, and liberating, and how is the community as a whole doing it? And in this case, I might be able to say, okay, one of the four I'm doing quite well, but somebody else in my community is doing another one strongly, and a third, and a fourth. And together, because we are cor unum et anima una, one heart and one spirit, then we are integrating the four components as a community. And the witness that we are giving as a community is a witness to Jesus as the one who integrates evangelization. The danger or the difficulty or the challenge is that on an individual level, to strive to be a disciple is to try and face up to all of those four and ask ourselves, okay, how am I dealing with this? Because the next step would be to say, but I'm not just on my own. I have got to find a faith community. I've got to find a community of disciples. Nevertheless, those four are a little bit on the abstract, a little bit on the theoretical, and there's another four I put the two other fours. There's one other group of four which is in italics, because they're all Greek words, the koinonia and the diakonia and the liturgia. That's basically another story about how the church itself has discerned how it should go and how it should be, a church in the world. But the other four that are in English, I want to put over on this side of the board, because these four seems to me are much more accessible for every single one of us. Encounter, table fellowship, foot washing, and boundary crossing. Now you can say, okay, give me some real day-to-day examples of discipleship. Show me how on a day-to-day basis I can be invested in evangelizing. And these ones are much more kind of incarnational. Jesus evangelizes by encounter, by table fellowship, by foot washing, and by boundary crossing. And every one of us can do that readily. Encounter. Viktor Frankl said, to love, you must encounter. And to me, this is exactly the way Jesus evangelizes. You cannot love the poor, because the poor is a category. It's an abstraction. You can't love a category. You can love a cat. You can't love a category. You can't love people in general, because there are no people in general. There are only people in particular. And therefore, the only way you can love people in particular is by encounter. If somebody tells you they love the poor, see if they know anybody. See if they know any name. All right? Jesus loves by encounter, one by one by one. And the quality of Jesus' encounters is the quality of evangelization. Jesus goes out of his way to encounter people and to give them dignity. You think of the story in Mark's Gospel where the anonymous holy woman, not a sinner, comes in and anoints Jesus' head, which is a priestly, kingly act. And when Mark is setting the story, he tells us that Jesus is at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper. Now, why do we need to know that? Because we need to know the kinds of people that Jesus encountered. Okay. Luke has it, he's in the house of a Pharisee. If Jesus is in the house of a Pharisee, that's a degree of upward mobility for the 12, for sure. But if Jesus is in the house of Spotty Simon, this is not upward mobility. This is kind of embarrassing. Right? So we need to pick up on some of these little insights and these little little bits of evidence in the New Testament. Jesus is in the house of Simon the leper. There is the example of his encounter. Okay. So who do I encounter? How do I encounter people? What's the quality of my encounter? Do I look at a person in the eye? Do I give them time? Do I really want to know something about them? Or do I give people short shrift? Maybe even if I'm giving somebody a beggar something, I may not even look at them. I may not even ask them a question. I may not even say, have a nice day, anything. The quality of my encounters is the quality of my evangelization. And Jesus encounters people as people, not just as poor or category or abstraction. The second one then is table fellowship, and table fellowship is horizontal ministry. And horizontal ministry really characterizes Jesus' life. There's a very fine book, little book, by Bob Karris, Franciscan, OFM, K-A-R-R-I-S, Bob Karris, Eating Your Way Through Luke's Gospel. Very nice little book. And basically what he says is that in Luke's Gospel, Jesus is either having a meal, coming from a meal, or just getting ready to go. And that's the way he operates. I heard Jerry Brown many years ago talking about the fact he was then no longer the mayor, no longer the governor of California. He was mayor of a town in Oakland, I think it was. And he said it was much easier for him and much more satisfying for him to be mayor of a relatively small town. And people asked him, well, how do you operate? He said, you start around the table. And I thought, there's a fine piece of theology. Start around the table. Think about the tables in our lives. The high tables and the low tables and the square tables and the round tables and the board tables, the tables that include, the tables that exclude. Think about the family dinner table that used to be the centerpiece of our homes years ago. And now many homes don't have a dinner table. And many families don't gather around it on an ordinary kind of day. One of the things that always strikes me very positively about the TV program Blue Bloods is that they spend so much time around the table. And it's astonishing. Where they, some of their animosity dissolves and some of their conversation becomes, private or public, and the little kids will say, it's time for us to go now. And they'll disappear because the adults are getting into something. But it's a place where people meet, and people meet with their differences and with their similarities. So Jesus' ministry is characterized by a multifarious kind of table fellowship. And the discipleship that Jesus is encouraging is radically inclusive and radically equal. Those are the two fundamental characteristics. Radically equal and radically inclusive. So what about me and tables? What about the tables of my life? Who do I eat with? Who do I like to be seen eating with? Who do I avoid? Who would I never invite to my table? There's an old guy who sits at the end of my street called Tom. And he's very, very heavy, very, very sick. And he's got awful legs. And he insists on rolling up his trousers and showing them to me. And they are ulcerated and absolutely awful. And so we talk and we do various things. And I said to him a few months ago, we should go for a meal. Oh, he said, great. So I'd had him at my house a few Christmases before, and it was Christmas Eve, and he was sitting in a blizzard begging at the end of the street. So he came up to my place, and he was freezing. And I said, would you like a drink? He said, do you have whiskey? I said, this is a religious house. Of course we have whiskey. So he had a whiskey, and that took him about a fourth of a second. And then he smiled, and he said, could I have another one? And I said, sure, you can have another one. So I had another one, and then he slowed down. But this particular day, I said, we'll go for a meal. And so we went, and we got to the place that he chose. I said, you choose. You're the one. You choose. Well, he said, I know a nice place where you can get lobster tails. So I said, okay, fine, Tom, that's what you want to do. We'll go for lobster tails. So we went for lobster tails, and thank you be to Jesus, the place was closed. I said, this is divine intervention. So I said, do you have any other place? Oh, he said, no, I know you can get a nice steak. So I said, okay, fine. So we went to this other place, and we got a nice steak. And we sat down, and he said, do you have any whiskey? I said, yeah, sure we do. He said, can I have a whiskey? I said, yeah. So he had a whiskey. He said, can I have another one? I said, yeah. So we had another one. And then we had a nice little meal. So about an hour and a half later, we came back to his place. He just lives across the street from me. And I have a very small car, and it's very difficult to get him into the car. And so when he get him out of the car, it's very difficult too, because he doesn't move very well, but he's very big. So he got out of the car, and he was totally exhausted, and the door's now open, and he's leaning on the top of the door, and I can just see the bottom of his face. So that's the best night I've had for 20 years. Table fellowship is the heart of Jesus' ministry. The heart of Jesus' ministry. So who do we eat with? When do we eat? That kind of thing. And of course, the great scandal is the table, the altar. The table of our Eucharist is a table of exclusion. It's not radically equal, and it's not radically inclusive. And the fault line runs right through our Eucharist. We are not disciples. We are not evangelizers in the spirit of Jesus, because we think our rules are more important than people. So that's table fellowship, and we have an enormous amount to learn. Foot washing, of course, is virtually the opposite of hierarchy. Hierarchy is when my head is higher than everybody else's. Foot washing is when my head is lower than everybody else's. So whose feet do I wash? Whose feet would I never think of washing? Who are the foot washers in our community? The people who work in our old people's homes and our hospitals and our care facilities, who day by day by day not only wash people's feet but wash their bodies and wash their effluvia. You know, there is table fellowship, and there is foot washing. And when Jesus washes his disciples' feet, he says to them, you must let me wash your feet, otherwise you can't be my disciple. But you must wash each other's feet, otherwise you can't be my disciple. So whose feet do we wash? And why were so many noses out of joint on Holy Thursday when Francis washed? Not only did he not wash 12 men's feet, and not only did he even wash a woman or two, but they weren't even Christians. Sounds very like Jesus to me. And then the final one is boundary crossing. And boundary crossing is not about national or international boundaries or seas or oceans or rivers. It's about my comfort zone, which finishes pretty well where my fingertips finish. Because just out of reach of me is somebody else like you. And this is where we meet, at the boundaries. And the thing about boundaries is that they are very, very ambiguous. We've got to cross them, but we know to our cost what's been happening in recent times in our own church. The boundaries have been transgressed. That's not boundary crossing, that's boundary transgression. So in order to meet other people, we have to go out of our comfort zone. But we have to find a way of doing it that is mutually respectful. And Jesus' boundary crossing is always mutually respectful. So what are the boundaries that I cross? And how do I show respect? And what are the boundaries I don't cross? We have our own little nests. We have our own little comfort zone. There's nothing wrong with that. A little bolt hole, a little private place where we can go away and be on our own, so long as it doesn't become a prison. as long as it doesn't isolate it, as long as it becomes like it was from Jesus, a way of going back out and encountering other people. So I think that these four on the left would be a much easier way to preach and to practice evangelization for anybody and everybody, from small kids to old, wizened theologians. But now then, to conclude, just to bring us right back to the very beginning, I started off by saying that the subject of mission is God, and therefore mission is first and foremost. But what has happened over the years is that we have tended to make the church the subject of mission. And we have even transformed, in a bad sense, the famous Ad Gentes II, the famous paragraph in the church in the modern world that says that the church is missionary by her very nature. And that paragraph has been twisted, if you like, to make the church in charge of the mission. Okay? But the paragraph actually says, the church on earth is by its very nature missionary, since it has its origin in the mission of the Trinity. The origin of the mission of the church is the Trinity. So therefore, we should say the mission has a church, not the church has a mission. We can talk about the church's mission, provided we know that we are talking about the church as an instrument and not as an executive, as an instrument of God's mission. So the mission has a church, and the church's job is to discern how it is being called to be faithful to the mission, and to do it in submission to the Spirit. If you saw the address of Pope Francis the other day, Tuesday, I think, of this week, where the first reading was Stephen saying, do not tame the Holy Spirit, as he was being killed. Paul has a wonderful thing. I'll just read you two sentences from it. A wonderful thing this week. The two sentences, however, are... I'll be back in a minute. The two sentences are over here, I think. Yes. Francis says, Vatican II is a beautiful work of the Holy Spirit. He criticized those who resist change and wish to turn back the clock and to tame the Holy Spirit, asking if 50 years after the Council, we have done everything the Holy Spirit was asking us to do. There's the spirit of mission. The answer is no, he said. We celebrate this anniversary, we put up a monument, but we don't want to be upset. We don't want to change. And what's more, there are those who wish to turn the clock back. This is called stubbornness and wanting to tame the Holy Spirit. You can get it on the NCR website for Tuesday. It's very good and very, very strong. Okay. So the mission has a church. The second thing is that very often we talk about our religious communities or our parishes or our dioceses as having the mission, and it should be the other way around. For me, the easiest way to remember this is simply that there was a time before which there was not a single Jesuit, and somehow God was managing. And then I can remember the relationship, okay? Jesuits are unquestionably important, but the mission is not the Jesuits' mission. It is God's mission. So the mission has the Jesuits. All right? And the Jesuits' job is to find out how, by being Jesuits, they can also be faithful to the mission. So the mission has the Sisters of Mercy. The mission has the Carmelites. The mission has the Dominicans. And each of them has got to, in turn, find out. And then you can come down to the parish level. My parish doesn't have the mission. The mission has my parish. God's mission has my parish. My parish is an instrument for God's mission. I don't have to be like the parish next door. I have to be faithful to the mission. And then in final analysis, the mission has me. And that's where it gets profoundly challenging. The mission has me. Why on earth does the mission have me? The only reason is God's providential foolishness. That's the only reason. God chose to choose me. I am contingently necessary, not absolutely necessary. But if it's good enough for God, then it should be good enough for me. God did not call the Jesuits to live forever, and God does not call me to live forever. God did not call the Jesuits to save the world, and God does not call me to save the world. We have a Savior, thank God. God called the Jesuits to be faithful to the mission and to ensure that the mission continues the way Jesus lives it. And God does exactly the same for you and me in a less consequential fashion, perhaps, but no less important to God. God chose you and me because God chose to want to choose you and me. And our only responsibility is to be fiercely faithful by living out the mission, by encounter, by table fellowship, by foot washing, and by boundary crossing. And I think the last thing I put on the page was a question, a curious question, that John Chichester asked many years ago: what do you want to be caught dead doing? And it's the final question. What do I want to be caught dead doing? Or what would I like, in best scenario, what would I like to be caught dead doing? It's the only important question, and the clock is ticking. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's given us a new way to think, and to, instead of just feeling badly, we now get to think newly. So thank you very much. And we have time for some questions, and I'd like to invite you to ask some questions.
Good, certainly, by all means. They don't have to be questions. They could be blinding insights. Yes. Doesn't the church have a problem with the professionalization of the mission?
Someone else has to do it.
Right. So it's the question of the professionalization of the faith. And the answer is, if you stick with Matthew's Great Commission, you can very easily but erroneously derive it entirely from the apostolic succession, which means the 11, which means the priests, the bishops, and the clergy. If you go to Vatican II and you rediscover the people of God, then you begin to realize that our commission is by virtue of our baptism and not by virtue of our ordination. And that's where the church's problem is institutionally over the last half century, with trying to balance this one against the other. So yes, and yet it's palpably obvious that women in the church, as people keep on saying, are the best educated group that had ever existed in the church. And many of the women clearly are better theologically educated than many of the priests. So yes, I mean, the answer is yes, and the second answer is, and there's no excuse for it. So if you look at that little statement from Francis on the NCR, you'll see how he says very strongly, you know, that we are trying to tame the Holy Spirit. We're trying to tell the Holy Spirit how things should be done. And we're trying to claim that it's actually the Holy Spirit saying. So absolutely, great sympathy for that, but we've all got to work on that. Okay, yeah.
I miss difference between proclamation and witness. To me, it sounds like both were preached but don't use words.
No, proclamation is verbal. It's systematic. It's organized. So yes, there has to be proclamation. But proclamation and witness amount to the same thing, which is evangelization. Okay. So sometimes you can. For example, my community started a mission in Pakistan in 1975. And Pakistan is a Muslim state, and it is absolutely forbidden to proclaim. Okay. Now, a lot of people have said, therefore, you cannot do mission. John Paul II came very close to this by saying, unless you proclaim, it is not mission. But the answer to that is, well, it depends. Do you proclaim with your mouth open or your mouth shut? So we've had a mission in Pakistan, as indeed have many, many others since long before that, and it's a mission of witness as proclamation. That's the thing. And their witness is very, very palpable. We were surrounded one day. The American Air Force was overflying Pakistan into Afghanistan, and the people below, you know, would see the planes thundering over. Everybody on this particular mission of ours it was an international community, and there was not, in fact, a single national United States citizen, but people using the English language speak of Americans, meaning generic outsiders. So they used to talk about the people in the mission as Americans. And I got up one day, and the house was surrounded by a mob, and it was an angry mob too. And then the next thing that happened was that the police came through, and they had firearms, and they came right through on the inside of the mob. So they were between us and the group, and I had no idea what was happening. And the police got a big loud hailer, and he said, just be very, very careful. He said, you're beginning to lose your grip. He said, these people in here are not Americans. They are our brothers. And he said, if any of you moves and if any of you breaks a window or anything, you'll be the ones who get shot. You know. So he wanted to kind of identify us. And they knew perfectly well that these not American brothers had evangelized by proclamation. You know, they were doing credit unions, they're doing hospital, one was a medical doctor. That was first class evangelization in the spirit of Jesus. But it was not explicitly proclamation. Well, again, yeah, I mean, we can spend a lot more time, and now I can open it up a bit more. Just simply to say that, just a little bit like the first question, we tended to professionalize mission. And we talked about missionaries, and missionaries are the ones who do the mission. And how do you define a missionary? By crossing international boundaries, by crossing salt water, by going a long way from home, by being an elitist and a professional. So I want to say the boundaries are much closer to home. The boundaries are just beyond your front door or just across your street. But many of us don't cross our boundaries. We don't see the people in our neighborhood. We don't hear the cries of the poor. We see the news, we say, oh, look at those poor people in X, Y, or Z country. I wish I could do something for them. And we trip over them in our own neighborhood. That's better? Okay, that's where I'm going with that. And we used to talk about, you know, people went on the missions or to the missions and then for whatever reason, you know, came back home. And there was always a kind of an assumption, either that they'd been, you know, drinking too much or something of that kind. And so therefore they were always rather apologetic in saying, I didn't want to leave. I came home because I was asked to come and, you know, do the collections and so on and so forth. Because the idea was if you're a real missionary, you should not be here. Vatican II really tried to open that up and said, you know, mission is the way in which you do what Jesus did. Jesus didn't get very far from home. But Jesus was the quintessential missionary. This centrifugal movement, this breathing out and breathing in, and breathing out and breathing in, which, of course, is beautifully recapitulated at the liturgy. We are the scattered people of God who gather at the liturgy. And the last words of the liturgy are, ite missa est, go and scatter again. Get on with the mission. So we are the scattered people who gather, and we are the gathered people who scatter. And our problem is that sometimes we are so scattered we don't gather. And sometimes we gather, but we're afraid to scatter. So there's the boundaries, and there's the mission, the inner and the outer, the breathing. But being changed by both, you know, as you are scattered, so you are depleted and changed, and so you gather again to be filled up and ready again to go out and be scattered and depleted and changed again. Yes? Probably linguist, you know, yeah, my language probably did.
So my question is, yeah, if we go beyond the grammatical issue, are we also talking substantively with those four functions, really verbs and doings?
Yes, absolutely, utterly, yes. It's no use talking about it. As Eliza Doolittle said, don't talk of love, show me! Yeah. Absolutely, no, you're right. We've got to be the proclaiming and the witnessing and the dialoguing and the liberating. Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Yes.
I was moved when you were talking about the man that you took out to dinner.
Tom.
Yes. And I'm guessing I wasn't the only one in the room who said
and also be stimulated by others to go for it, you know, go for it. Yeah, definitely. Or we can have the kind of community that is just kind of lolling like a fallen souffle. Just, you know, that's, you know, not doing anything. That's what I call not religious living, but religious twitching. Can you just be a little louder?
Okay. You talk about in the country like Pakistan.
Yes.
We have to do witness first before proclamation.
Or that witness is the way we
yeah.
proclaim.
Also like my country, Vietnam, because when the communists took over, we have to do the same thing. But here, in this country, in each archdiocese, you know, what way we do? We witness first or we have to proclaim the proclamation first?
I think it depends upon all kinds of circumstances. If, for example, you are the parish pastor or the leader of the DRE in a parish, you have a responsibility for proclamation of some kind. On the other hand, I think that a lot of people are sick and tired of proclamation, and they want to see something else. They want to see what it might mean, you know, palpably. So I think that's a question for discernment. But that's exactly the question that Jesus has to ask, you know. How do I do what I need to do? How do I know how to do what I need to do? It depends on the pastoral need, the pastoral circumstances, okay? If somebody comes to you and they're bleeding, you don't start up by proclaiming, you know? And that's what Jesus does. You know, if he comes and people are in a particular situation, that's what he addresses first, okay? Whereas if he gets the Pharisees standing in the back and is sitting like that and criticizing, he'll proclaim to them. So it's all a question to me of trying to find the way in which the integrated evangelization can be best articulated in the circumstance. Yes.
You quoted the Holy Father a few minutes ago. In terms of the topic of this discussion today, you know, it's difficult to see into the future. What are some of your hopes? What's your sense of Pope Francis?
The sense of possibly Pope Francis. Well, I can't gaze into a crystal ball any more than you can, but what I will say is one thing, that when I was a young boy, really, Pius XII was still alive. And when I was a young boy, I assumed that Pius XII somehow would live forever. Pius XII died, and John the 23rd came to the papacy. And if you count 5 years from the time that Pius XII was alive, you are into the third session of Vatican II. Now, to me, that's the most profound shift, certainly in my life, because when Pius XII was still alive, people were saying very much what they were saying 3 months ago. You know, will we ever see any change? Maybe now, you know, the 3 months is the beginning of a 5 years, at the end of which we will say, wow. I don't know, but if we allow the Holy Spirit, you know, to breathe freely, and I believe Francis is really, really trying, but it's like pushing against, you know, a massive mountain when he's got to try and engage with the Curia, and he's got to try and engage with the protocol, and the Pope is breathing down his neck, metaphorically speaking, you know, the other Pope. So it's...
Bishop
of Rome. Yeah, that's where you see all the subtleties where the present Pope doesn't call himself Pope, which of course is why the Orthodox Patriarch came for the first time since the year 1053. Because he says, I can deal with the Pope of Rome. I mean, I can deal with the Bishop of Rome. I can't deal with the Pope of the, you know, entire universe. So I don't want to speculate, but I'm certainly very, not optimistic, hopeful. Hope is a theological virtue. Optimism is for the birds. Well, I mean, if you live in Chicago and you know you've followed the Cubs for 100 years, you're not an optimist. But you might still live in hope. But there are some really, really very strong signs. And even the ambiguous one this week about the LCWR, the women religious, there was something in there that was not absolutely closing any doors to me. And the women's response was, we had a good discussion. You know, I'm very, very hopeful about this. All right? think probably we're getting close to the time when people need coffee. Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry. I think it's about charism and discerning and leading. I think the core of the answer is in your question itself. I think you already have a very, very strong intuition about you know, priorities here. What I will say very briefly is that there is a significant amount of confusion today in the language of charism and charisma. Charisma is a word that comes into sociology, and it means a certain kind of leadership, a certain kind of certainty about oneself. We use it when we talk about charismatic leadership. Charism, though, is a theological word. And charism always means a gift of the Holy Spirit, which is not a personal gift. The charism is always given for the community. And the charism that is received is always to be given away. You know? So we are the recyclers of charism. If we have received something from God, it is our duty to recycle it. It is not our duty to hold on to it. And it is not our duty to confuse charism as something which we have received for other people. It belongs to other people. We have got to be very careful not to confuse charism with this charisma, as if I'm the most important person in the world, or indeed anybody else for that matter. So the charism is the grace of the Holy Spirit, and it is for the churches, for the people. And what you and I have got to do is to stimulate it as widely as possible and spread it as widely as possible. Okay. Now, it may be that as you do that, you are doing it as a charismatic leader. But we all have to be very careful not to allow the charismatic leadership to suffocate or, you know, obscure the charism, which is for everybody. That's as close as I can get because, you know, it's getting close to the other time. All right. Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Very, very depleting. Did you see Bishop Gumbleton's response this week?
No.
That's also on the NCR website. Bishop Gumbleton, of course, now from the privileged position of being a retired bishop, can say things that he wasn't able to say before. And basically what he's doing is appealing to the internal forum, appealing to the conscience, and saying, you know, if you feel that you can and should do a certain thing, then you must do that certain thing. Now, that's all assuming that the conscience is well-formed, and that's where the rules and regulations come in, and people get, you know, kind of stop you. But I'm not a pastor, and if I were a pastor, I think I would not be a pastor for very long. because I think one of the things that I would try to do would be to stimulate that internal forum thing. And I, in other words, what I would try and do is find a way of either definitely not asking people, you know, and not saying before they come, you mustn't come if. I would say everybody is welcome, because that's what Jesus says. And if I could avoid scandal, then I would avoid scandal by not being the judge and jury. But somebody would report me immediately. Yeah. So it is a very, very problematic issue, one which I think that there are seeds and signs of a solution with Pope Francis. I think he's got a deep, deep pastoral heart. And he's already told, he's already excoriated his old priests for refusing communion to divorced and remarried people in South America. So, I mean, there is hope. And what we've got to do is keep hope alive and do the best we can. I mean... Let me give you a hypothetical. A hypothetical. You are a hospital chaplain and you are taking communion in a hospital. And you give Holy Communion to one person, yes, and another person says, can I have it too? Yes. What do you do? Yes. Next question. that's where I would seek a little space.
Okay. Tony, thank you so much. Thank you.